Welcome to Cybersecurity in Healthcare, What Hospital Executives Need to Know. This is part one of a three-part series on cybersecurity. In this session, we're going to talk about terminologies. We'll talk about some of the threats and the threat actors and the breaches that have been occurring in healthcare. In part two, we'll look at the trends and the challenges that we face. And in part three, we'll talk about implementing controls, a cybersecurity plan, and how to prepare ourselves for a board presentation. In this session, as I said, the objectives are to go over the terminologies associated with cybersecurity, as well as to educate on the cyber threats and cyber agents that are responsible for these breaches. I'm Tom Walsh, your presenter. I'm a certified information system security professional, and I've co-authored four books on healthcare information security. Now, before we go too far into the session, I feel like it's important that we take a little bit of time to explain some of the terminologies that are used. In cybersecurity, the term breach has a specific meaning. Now, IT people think of breach as it means to some type of an attacker, hacker getting through the perimeter of their security, of their network. Actually, there's a well-defined definition within the HITECH Act that explains that a breach really is unauthorized access to protected health information, or PHI as it's referred to. The term cyber we hear often, and really it means the internet and computers. And then hacktivist is a fairly new term that we've used these days, and it's a combination of both hacker and activist. And what it is it's folks who are either socially or politically motivated to get their cause out there, and they're using hacker techniques to get their message across. You may have heard the term phishing, and phishing is a form of malware. And what you find is this is an email that comes to unsuspecting individuals, and it's a form of social engineering. And what they're trying to do is to gain your trust and having you to do something. In most cases, they're getting you try to get you to click on a link that's embedded in the email message. You may have heard of ransomware. Ransomware is another form of malicious code that's out there. And what ransomware does is what the name implies. It kidnaps your data and holds it ransom, using some type of encryption to hide the data from you, and then forcing organizations to pay a ransom either in real dollars or in bitcoins in order to get the decryption key and get their data back to where it was. Hacking and cyber attacks are on the rise in healthcare, and we got to ask ourselves, what's happening? In 2015, we saw a dramatic rise in hacking attempts. In fact, in the first 6 months of 2015, we saw a major increase, in particular, to health plans. Now, I've been tracking the breaches that get reported to the Department of Health and Human Services on their website. These are breaches that affect over 500 patients. And what we have found is that over the years, hacking has always been a pretty low percentage of the breaches that get reported, and yet the number of patient lives affected has really skyrocketed. And that's highlighted in this table on this slide at the very bottom. You can see that in 2015, the total number of patient lives affected was over 111 million. 111 million. That means one out of every three Americans basically had their data hacked as a result of a breach in healthcare. This pie chart shows, again, how the number of breaches that get reported by percentages, that hacking still is one of the lowest on the table. But if we look a little bit closer as to the number of affected lives, since we've been tracking this, when it went into effect in 2010, the reporting to the Department of Health and Human Services, what we find is 75%, of all patients who have reported or have had their data affected by a breach, it's been caused by hacking. This slide illustrates the top six healthcare breaches to record as of today, the records here. And these are breaches that all have affected at least 1 million or more patients. Now, there's a couple of things I want you to note in this slide. And the first of all, that all six were reported in 2015. In addition to that, another thing to look at is five out of the six that were reported, actually the breach occurred somewhere before 2015. In some cases, almost a year before it was detected or reported. So this is very alarming that these are big breaches that are occurring and that it takes a while to not only detect them, but then to report them as well. So what are some of the cyber threats that we need to be aware of? Well, I've tried to minimize my list down to what I think are the top four primary threat agents that we need to worry about. And the first one is hackers. But I call it Hacker 2.0. And the reason I say that is, years ago, if you were to ask, what's the profile of a hacker? It was pretty simple. We'd say, typically, it was a young white male in their early 20s. They probably still lived at home with their parents. Socially maladjusted, probably never been on a date. That was the common profile of a hacker. That's what we think. But it has changed. Hackers are now part of organized crime, syndicates. The Russian mafia, for example, recruits some of the top programmers to become hackers for them. Hacking has also moved now to nation states. We've seen in the paper there's been reported attacks that have led or traced back to countries like North Korea and the Lizard Squad and China and Iran. So we know that nation states are looking at cybersecurity as a tool for warfare. It's getting quite nasty. I mentioned in the terminologies about hacktivists, and one of the most well-known cases in healthcare occurred in March of 2014. It was a case involving a child that was taken from a mother and placed in the care of a hospital because the child needed treatment and the mother refused to take the child to the hospital. The state then became the guardian of the child. The mother thought that the state had kidnapped her child. So she turned to social media for help. And this group called Anonymous took up her cause. And what they did is they began a directed denial of service attack against Boston Children's Hospital and all of its affiliates. The attack was so bad that Boston Children's Hospital had to unplug from the internet for almost 2 days. Wow, what an impact that was on not only the hospital, but all of its affiliates. So we can see that through the power of social media, people who have a cause that they think is worthy, they can gather a group of strangers to help organize and launch an attack. Now, interesting enough about this particular one was that it raged on for a good week until somebody in the group posted and said, "What are we doing? This is a children's hospital. Children's lives are at stake. Is that what we're about?" And I think that message resonated with the rest of them because soon after that was posted, the hacking attempts and the denial of service stopped. We have our own employees, malicious insiders. It's not that uncommon that we find that some individuals are taking patient information for their own personal use and gain. In fact, one of the major breaches that occurred in 2015 was a health plan where one of their employees was stealing members' information and then using that information to file false tax claims. The last area that we need to be concerned about is our own business partners, or what we call them in healthcare, business associates. Business associates are responsible for anywhere between 20 to 30% of all the reported breaches to the Department of Health and Human Services. This is an alarming number. Now, I say it varies because every quarter I go to the Department of Health and Human Services website where these breaches that affect over 500 patients are reported. They call it the wall of shame. So I've been gathering the statistics and it varies, but it's at least a 25% chance that one of your business associates could be responsible for a breach. So we need to consider that as well. So what are the threats as far as cyber threats that we need to worry about? As I mentioned, business associates are responsible for at least 25% of the reported breaches. And as of December 31st, here is the statistics. It was at 21% during that quarter. But you can see we're talking close to 27, maybe million lives affected by breaches caused by our business associates. And for most healthcare organizations, the cyber insurance you have does not cover business associates. So what are some of the targets of the cyber criminals? What are they looking for? If you had asked me this a few years ago, I would have had a different list in a different order. But today, the number one thing they're going for is user ID and passwords. Now, I know that kind of seems odd that that would be the first thing they would go for, but more and more, organizations are encrypting the data. And the way you need to get to that data is you have to be an authorized user. And if you can present a proper user ID and password, the data then will be unencrypted. So encrypted data is no good to a hacker. They need to get it in a plain text format. So that's why they're going after user credentials. And many times they start with a simple user and then try to elevate their privileges to something like a system administrator. Once they're in, their target is pretty clear. They want protected health information. The FBI has put out statistics about what the value of credit card information that's stolen is worth on the black market versus what is a medical record worth on the black market. Estimates range from about a dollar to maybe, you know, a dollar and a quarter for a stolen credit card. And that's because credit card companies have perfected the anti-fraud systems. They really can crack down when somebody steals a credit card. But not so much on protected health information. We don't have that sophistication. We can't quickly detect when there's fraud going on. Therefore, the value of this is very high. And in fact, if you get somebody's medical record, you get a lot about that person. You can get their social security number, their address. You can get a lot of good information. So it's no surprise that a medical record sells on the black market anywhere between $50 to $60 per record. That's a lot. That's a lot. And of course, I mentioned credit cards and banking information. Those have always been a target. But I said banks and credit card companies are much better at detecting fraud. Social security numbers are important, in particular, social security numbers of children. IRS rules changed back in the 80s requiring all children to get social security numbers. Consequently, there's a lot of young people with social security numbers who don't have a bad track record when it comes to credit. So that's why the social security numbers of young people are a prime target for hackers. We also have to look at research data. Healthcare generates a lot of research. And why would a company or a nation state invest millions or even billions of dollars into research when you can just come in and steal it from the United States? Smartphones are an easy target, and I'll talk a little bit more about this in another session, and biomedical devices as well. We have a lot of biomedical devices today that run on wireless networks, and they're accessible to the internet. So these are just some of the prime targets that we have of cyber criminals today. Well, in this first part, what we did was cover, you know, some information about the terminology used in cybersecurity. I tried to explain to you why healthcare data has become such a target now for hackers. We talked about some of the cyber threats, the threat agents, and the targets that they're looking for. And as I mentioned, protected health information within healthcare has become very valuable to those. In part two, we're going to go a little bit deeper into explaining some of the trends and threats that we have. And then finally, in part three, we'll talk about a plan of attack and how to prepare for a board presentation on cybersecurity. I want to take this time to say thank you to all of you who are attending and listening to this session. Thank you very much.